So we're live now. Hi friends, thank you for joining me again for another session of Career 360. You know, if the pandemic has achieved one thing, it's forced the educational institutions to go live, education to go live, online rather, and ensured that what we would have achieved maybe a couple of decades later, it's pushed us in terms of innovation, adaptability and all, and forced most of the institutions, students, schools, colleges and everyone to start teaching online. And for me, the big question that keeps coming back is, you know, while we say that we've gone online, education has gone online, it seems to be the flavor of everyone that we talk to in the education space, right from regulators to the government, to the institutions and all. And they keep talking of how everything is normal and there is nothing that has changed. In fact, it's improved and all. The question that keeps coming back to me, is a Zoom call an online education? What does online exactly mean? Does it mean that a video lecture given online, you know, is an online education? So there are quite a few questions that keep coming back to me, because somewhere along the line, we seem to be believing or thinking that, you know, we suddenly have found the magic potion for all the problems that we have in education, and that is going online. It seems as if that's the magic potion that we have to control the cost of education, to make it more affordable, to improve efficiency and whatnot. So what I thought was that instead of having my own views, getting into in the way of what, how you think, I thought I will talk to a person who actually pioneered, in a sense, technical and online education also. He's the one who founded NIIT way back when none of these regulators ever thought of, technical education. He's the one who actually thought of creating a informal education setup, which is completely delivered based on technology and so on and so forth. And the guest that I have today, the expert that I have today, is Mr. Rajendra S. Pawar, Padma Bhushan awardee. And more importantly, he's also the founder of NIIT University. So from NIIT Limited, where he's a chairman and co-founder of NIIT Limited, he's moved on to get into formal education in terms of creating NIIT University. And I'm absolutely certain and sure that he's trying to do things much ahead of the time in terms of what exactly online would mean and how would a university adapt to online education. Because quite clearly, with the UGC regulations that have come in, which suggest that you can actually deliver 40% of the education online, the students will have to make a choice of deciding colleges based on the infrastructure, the facilities that mean what exactly online education would be. You know, in a sense that they need to be judging, choosing colleges based on the kind of facilities that colleges or universities have to ensure that the education that is to be delivered online is actually delivered in the right way, in the proper way. So we have Mr. Pawar with us, as I said today. I'm going to speak to him over the next 1 hour and possibly take a few of your questions also of what exactly does this entire thing mean. Thank you, Mr. Pawar, for joining us today.
My pleasure.
Sir, as an opening comment, what do you perceive of this entire conversation, which is about online education, sir? Because you pioneered everything. You know, you started NIIT Limited, you started NIIT University, and you actually thought of much of this much ahead of our times. Because I know a lot of my friends who graduated from NIIT in the informal setup. It's not a university those days, mind you. But what is your take on this entire thing of online education, sir?
So thank you, Mahesh. Thank you for having me on this discussion. The topic is very important for the world now, but let me say that for all of us who've been involved in NIIT, now it's going to be 40 years next year. Technology has been the crux of the issue for us right from the beginning. So maybe I'll start by giving a very quick story, if I may say, of these four decades. And what role has technology played during these periods and today's situation where everybody is so focused on online? So also to clarify that NIIT Limited as a company was founded in 1981. And the university, which is the not-for-profit that the founders have created, was started in 2009. So we've had the experience of 30 years before we started the university at NIT Limited, and the last 10 years of the NIT University itself, benefiting from the full experience of 30 years prior to that, and pushing the boundary on the use of technology in every aspect of learning. So when I look at these 40 years, in the 1980s, when we launched as a startup, NIT Limited, we did use the word multimedia. Because at that time, IT was an unknown term. In fact, computers was a word which was used. And there was no formal teaching on this subject. And we knew that there's going to be a shortage of tech. We were stuck in a situation where we would have to teach without having the resources. And so we looked at technology at that time to see, can technology help us deal with this issue, which is that there's a demand for people to learn technology, but there's not enough faculty. So we looked at technology at that time as engineers, as perhaps part of the solution. But that time, what was state of the art was the color TV and the very huge VCR, 3/4-inch VCR, the video cassette, videotape player. So that represented the method to bring in technology into the classroom, where you had very high quality recorded lesson by great experts from all over the world. And so we, in the decade of the 80s, we used that, but then we discovered that those materials were built in the US or Europe, and the accent was an issue, the examples were not relevant. So quite early in that decade, we started experimenting with building our own digital content in India. And within a decade, we had one of the largest facilities for building learning content. But that time, the dominant medium was the video, the color TV and the video. That was one. And the second was that we were beginning to use computers to give practical training for more than half the time in the classroom, because we realized that people were there to learn something new, and that just using a board and presenting stuff would not work. And if they did not learn things in a concrete fashion, it wouldn't work. So we were focused on two things, which from that time, which have remained to this time. And when we come to online learning, we'll see the absolute significance of that fundamental principle, which is, we said that we are not in the activity of teaching. We are in the activity of learning. So the emphasis is not on the teacher, it's on the learner, because there were no teachers, you have to remember that, but there were enough potential learners. So it had to be, everything had to be learner-centric, not teacher-centric. We hear these terms all the time, but that time, remember, there weren't any teachers. So we had to be learner-centric. That was one dimension. And the second dimension was, it didn't have to be syllabus-centered, that here is what we're going to teach you. It had to be outcome-based. It had to be objective-driven, that at the end of this lesson, the learner should be able to demonstrate A, B, C, and D. So from the dominant method, which was available at that time for all of us as learners in the normal system, in the formal system, which is teacher-centered, syllabus-based. The transition from there to learner-centered and objective-driven or outcome-based was an essential part of the issue. And as we will, I hope we will understand during the course of this discussion, that is perhaps the most fundamental move which we have to do as we look at online, where the learner has to learn and the learner should know what he or she is learning and should be able to measure it and see it for themselves. And the other people should see it are the beneficiaries of that skill, which is typically the employers. So therefore, this was a fundamental shift, and that got us to start looking at many methods. So the learner had to get more computer time to do their exercises, and the exercises were such that if 3 of them were doing it or 10 of them were doing it in a room on their computers, they could immediately see who is doing what. They didn't have to base it on a judgment of someone else, because if they had to write a program or whatever they had to do, whatever was the output, it was possible for them to see the outcome. So the decade of the 80s went with limited use of computers because computers were expensive, but we did a lot of work to give computer time or hands-on time, as we called it, because that was the only way for learners to acquire skills and know that they are acquiring skills. Now, the 90s was a very different decade. The 90s, the internet arrived on the scene. The PC was there. And the Apple devices started coming. So there was a huge change in the ability of the learner to work with a device which had much better capability to interact, much better graphics, and also connectivity. They could, the lines were not too good even at that time, so we had to be very careful. In fact, in 1996, we launched at that time the NIIT NetVarsity, which was the first university on the net. But I think it was too much ahead of its time because we stuck with the kind of problems which people are encountering today, but you can imagine, to get onto the internet and try and do a class. So, but what we did was we used that capability for our tens of thousands of students we had that time in many, many countries. We used that capability to get students to be in the classroom, but outside the classroom to do many things that they could do on the internet or on the network. So that decade went into grappling with this problem of a new capability on the horizon, but not working so well, not because of us, not because of students, but because of available infrastructure. Now, the next decade, the 2000 to 2010, many things improved on the infrastructure. And at that time, actually, you may recall that the bigger issue that time was the dot-com, post-dot-com world, the post-Y2K world. So while the 90s showed a lot of demand for talent and a lot of still limited infrastructure, the next decade continued. And in fact, at that time, we then dabbled with newer subjects. We said, instead of only teaching IT, which we did for 10 years or 12 years, now let us use technology to teach other subjects. And the two other subjects, two fields in which we went in, one was the whole banking and finance and financial technologies, which the banking sector was growing and they needed talent. And then we partnered with ICICI, which was the great organization in banking. And we took their domain knowledge, took our technology knowledge, and we offered superior online offering, but blended offering. I'll use the word blended, and I'll then convert to the word we want to use today, which is seamless. We went to blended, and the blended meant that there are those things you can do online, and there are those things that you can only do in a class, and I'll touch on that. Because to think that everything can be online, I want to remove that doubt from people's minds, is not possible, not desirable, not appropriate. But what the blend is, what the seamlessness is what we'll talk today. And now we've come into the fourth decade, where networks have improved, devices have improved, smartphones are available to everybody. So the idea of learning anytime and from anywhere has become much more practical. But I have to say this, that it has taken the COVID to get everybody to realize that they have to change their behavior if they have to succeed. So what we have seen is that those organizations which have been dabbling with technology for these 20, 30, 40 years have encountered the problems of behavior change, preparing teachers to do it differently, preparing infrastructure to do it differently. And they've gathered many, many capabilities which were not coming to the surface till the COVID time. And in the COVID time, we can see the difference between those who were grappling with the problems in the background and those who are now confronted with a situation where all that you can see is that you can know how to connect using a channel, but nothing else which is to go behind that in terms of how people learn, how to build exams, how to build examples, what to do in a class, what to do online. That's a very complex experience which takes time to do. And so we see the current situation where, because of COVID, nobody had a choice. Nobody has a choice. So everybody's grappling with the problem. And all that I can say is that those who've been on this journey for at least two or three decades have assimilated and accumulated a lot more experience, which is not so visible, except that it's becoming possible for them to be able to give learner-centered, outcome-driven learning.
Sir, it's interesting that you talked of building content, engagement, and outcome-driven, right? And a lot of people seem to be thinking that online education is the magic potion that India needs to move ahead. You have written a very incisive piece recently, which is about bored students and exhausted teachers. Would you mind telling me what exactly you had in mind when you wrote that piece, sir?
Well, first of all, I'm not the only one who's written, but I was getting, I was talking to many academics, many students during COVID, many school principals, many faculty members, and they were struggling with the situation, particularly those for whom this is a new phenomenon. And for example, a teacher in school, for example, can manage maybe 30 children, and the teachers have learned over the centuries how to manage 30 children in the classroom. All of a sudden, those are 30 little blobs on a screen, and the teachers trying to figure out what's going on here. So teachers are getting very troubled. Even to manage attendance, they don't know. They don't know whether the child is there or not there. And another complexity. Very often the child sitting at home has got the mother by the side. So now you have a teacher who's dealing with 30 students and 30 mothers. So the teachers were completely nonplussed with this inability, since many of them were dealing with it for the first time. And the students watching a screen for a number of hours, even if you see a film, you have to take a break. So they were really not excited and engaged. And this is a very common phenomenon. And yet, I think everybody's excited, everybody's building a hype. And I thought it's only fair to show society a very clear mirror on what the situation is, so that we start addressing it, so that we recognize that it's not just about putting a teacher in front of a camera and getting students in front of the screen. That is not online learning. That is only a medium.
Yeah.
It's like saying that you went into a class and learning happened. We know it doesn't happen. So I thought it very important, and I've seen now many pieces being written by people who are experiencing for the first time. And the teachers are saying it's really so difficult, and the students are saying that I can't grip my attention. The parents are getting anxious. So there is a lot of angst. And I thought it's appropriate. And the reason for writing basically was this, that people who suddenly stumbled upon this need are finding that the number of dimensions we have to learn in are not trivial, not small. The number of problems, for example, many of the principals are talking about the social issue that children are feeling loneliness, because we do know, all of us know, you will remember, Mahesh.
Yeah.
If I ask you to remember your school days, what do you remember the most? You're not going to remember, give me stories of inside the classroom.
That's right. Yeah.
It was all outside. The whole socialization process happens outside the classroom. In fact, the collaboration that happens in a class is not between student and teacher. That is between students. So that's the socialization and the social challenge in the way it's happening, which is one-to-one. And the psychological problem is there as well. The stress of teachers dealing with this new situation, they're looking into a camera, they don't know what's happening behind it. Students are there or not there, they don't know. And then students are playing pranks. I think we do expect students to play pranks, except that the typical teacher learned how to deal with pranks. I think they have hundreds of years of experience, but they don't know the pranks on the computer. So it's a struggle.
But sir, we now know that, you know, the earlier model was not the right model. The current model might not be the ideal model in terms of online learning. And UGC also is coming down on the whole thing, saying that institutions can actually deliver 40% of their education course curriculum online. Is there any model that you have based on your 40 years of experience of creating NIT and 10 years of NIT University? Is there some kind of a recommendation that you have for the institutions out there to adapt or adopt so that this online education can actually have a better steam?
Well, an example that comes to mind is my own school where I studied, the Sindhya School in Gwalior. And I want to take that example because there we have been on it for 20 years now, I have to say this, right? But we discovered that if we hadn't done dozens of things over these 20 years, our ability to create a situation, so the school has now coined a counterphrase to my phrase, which is bored students and exhausted teachers. They've flipped it around to say that this 20 years of work that they have done, I'll give some examples of the kind of things it takes. And they had coined a new phrase, which is rejuvenated teachers, engaged students. So now, many teachers in the school also, not all of them took to it like fish to water, but there was extensive amount of training over the years on how to use one technical dimension after the other. So for first example, we know that most children who are here also today would have been exposed to the whiteboards and to computers itself and so on and so forth. So teachers have been struggling with that. They were building digital content, they were downloading, they were integrating the internet into many sessions. They were doing a host of things over a period of time to deal with all dimensions. So what are all the dimensions? Let me touch on that. First of all, there is content. Now, content itself means very little. In the olden days, it would have meant that if you join a school and they tell you, sit in the library, we have all the content and no one's going to deal with you. And so many years later, you should come out enlightened. Maybe 0.001%. Those who are highly super motivated may do it, but for bulk of the people, that's not education. So today there is unlimited content for free. It's like the library of the world is with you. But each of you, I'm sure, everyone will understand that if someone took you into the biggest library in the world and told you, hey, here, come here every morning and go in the evenings, you're not going to learn much. So content is not it. But of course, without content, nothing happens. But content is important. Then comes the whole process of the pedagogy, the method of learning. And all of us remember, even from time immemorial, that the very good teachers followed the model which we're trying to use in online, that they would pose problems. They would excite our curiosity. They would get us to work in groups. They would ask a question and go away and leave five people to collaborate and do some stuff and create ourselves and say, go to the library if you want. Open your book and do the exam. So we've seen glimpses of experimental pedagogies where a lot was left to students in collaborative method to learn. So even if the content was all around you, you had to put an objective which learners had to learn. You had to define problems they had to solve. You had to give them projects. And we talk of problem-based learning as a method, that you give a problem, give people the resources, walk away and let them solve the problem. Interestingly, the science of pedagogy, the science of learning, over the last 200 years, even 200 years ago, there were many brilliant ideas, but they could not be implemented in the classroom. It needed much more learner-centered, interactive learning, which the technology of today is giving. But these were not brought into the classroom unless they were pushed extensively. So content is there, methods have to be there. Then most important is teachers. Now, teachers in the B.Ed. colleges and so on, and when they come into school or what they did themselves, are only living out the method they learned or they went through themselves. There has to be a very major shift of gears for teachers on how to use technology for learning. And what we are noticing is, when I talk of exhausted teachers, is those institutions which haven't done heavy investments in teacher training over the last 10, 15 years while technology was coming. And for them, it is basically you come in front of a very good platform and you deliver learning. Now, teacher training to me is perhaps the single most difficult problem to solve, which is why I say that institutions which have been dabbling with it for 10, 20 years have struggled, and the teachers have struggled and have come to grips with using many tools and technologies and methods and pedagogies and defining learner-centered, outcome-driven learning. And they've learned that you can make it seamless, that I give you an exercise now, but you can go home and do it. So we have focused our education in the university in a residential mode, because to us, we call it a 24/7 campus, because every minute on campus is an opportunity to learn. And the students can be in their room, they can be in the classroom, they can be in the library. They could be recalling whatever they missed because it's somewhere available, recorded for them. They can send their messages, they can put their questions, their exams come to them. So this cumulative experience of teacher learning is the single most difficult part. And when I talk of exhausted teachers, it's because they're working very hard. I have to give my hats off to the teachers of today who are on multiple steep learning curves as they're standing in front of this new situation. And so for teachers, it's a very big issue. And then school administrators. So let me pose a small example and I'll stop there.
Yeah.
Now, in a classroom in 1 week, let's say if I'm in school for a week or college for a week, if I learn 100 units in those 100 units of time, today people have very little idea that if I go online, will I cover 100 or will I cover 50 or will I cover 150? So for learner administrations who have to build a timetable to cover a curriculum, they have very little clue of how to plan for it and when to put the exam dates, so how to do timetabling. So learning administrators have an equally different challenge, and they're all trying to cope with these challenges, leave alone the difficulty of what children are encountering as difficulties at their end, and parents are encountering as difficulties at their ends. So this article was written essentially to confront the reality, and then I gave you the example of an institution which has worked systematically to be able to work around in the last 2 months to put all their experience and knowledge together of how to design curriculum, how to put digital content. Then, for example, in the online learning space, they have to make sure that students have done some work before they come on the screen, because we want to cut down screen time. We don't want too much screen time. We want students to do independent learning before, not easy. We want them to do some problem solving later, maybe not with the teacher, but with other students. So these techniques have to be done.
I'm also coming to that question, sir, because a lot of institutions are now talking of blended learning, right? Now, the blended learning ecosystem is, at this point in time, not the most mature one that we have. Institutions are confusing between what can be delivered online and what should be delivered offline. Students are more confused of what can be learned offline and what needs to be can be learned online. So would you have any take on the blended learning ecosystem that we're talking about, sir?
So in a sense, it's a combination of everything I said, and I can show a chart, but I won't take too long on it, but I'll try to say how many elements it has. So I'm just going to put up the chart. Yeah. So do you, can we see the chart?
Could be the chart, please. Yeah.
So now this is the complete, just reduce the size a little. Yeah. Reduce the size a little of the chart. Let me get the chart. Yeah. Now, I just want to explain in just fraction of a minute, but the first message the chart gives is that there are many, many things that go on in learning. So you have admission process. You see the center of the circle, it talks of a comprehensive system, but around that you have the first circle has from admissions to the academic process, to linkage, to administration, to governance. Many things are going on in the institution. Just look at the academic piece. Next circle, you have timetable, classroom, lab, exams, library, for example. Like that, you have things which are co-curricular. Like that, you have the placement activity for college students. You have the alumni activity. Like that, you have entrepreneurship activities. And around these charts, you have many, many activities that go on. And then outside you see, right on top, you see students and parents are interacting. On the left-hand side, you see there are regulatory bodies which define rules. On the right-hand side, you see the people who employ, or industry as I'm using. So now there is this whole picture which is going on. And if you notice, I put an arrow pointing to three things, which is saying what is considered today digital is only virtual classrooms, in some cases, virtual labs and exams. So today people are grappling with only one or two or three of these things. But unless the institution has learned how to deal with every one of those components in a digital fashion, the student, if you say student-centered, then the student has to have access and possibility with everything. So, for example, the extracurricular, which I personally consider very important. So at the university, for example, there are ideathons, hackathons going on. There's an art competition going on with people from home are putting up their art online. So there are many activities that go on, which all of which have to be ready and available to the institution and faculty and administrators in the institution, and they have to reach the students, and the students have to be able to interact with them. So I didn't want to go through the detail, but to say that blended learning means all things have to be put together, and the learner should be able to go into the web, into the app, and actually navigate from one to the other rather than just seeing a teacher teaching. So it's a comprehensive topic, and perhaps if you have questions, I will go to those questions.
We'll go through that, sir, because the issue that the students are confronted today, sir, is that while the students know that when they join a college, a lot of learning would happen online, they're unable to decide or choose a college based on what exactly online means. And that's where my next question comes in, sir. And these are students who have written.
So we can go to the full screen, I guess. We can remove.
Surbhi, you can remove the chart, please. So the question is, if online, and a lot of institutions claim this, sir, that online education is far better than what they were doing offline. So maybe it's a bombastic conversation that they have, but they seem to claim that online is far better than offline and so on and so forth. So if online is so as good as what is claimed, then why should the student even go offline to a campus, sir? Because the fee also is 1/5 or 1/6 of the whole thing. What is your take on this online versus offline? How does the student go about choosing the mode of education?
So, as I said, I think quite early in the process, it is, we are not attempting, educationists are not attempting and should not be attempting to replace conventional learning and the development of a student by a simple label called online. So I use the term blended, but I will use seamless after showing the diagram to see that for a student, there should be a seamless movement from one thing to the other without commuting, perhaps, but they'll be commuting. So first of all, let's recognize there are certain things you cannot do online. Let me touch on those as we start in the defining the respective roles. So the socialization process, which is a very fundamental process, very fundamental. Perhaps we know that collaboration even in school time is very important. But when you come into college, at that phase of your life, it is about building relationships. It's about you're arriving at an age, you're an adolescent, you're finding your own feet in society, you're building relationships, you're building a sense of identity. And therefore, the socialization process, where you start recognizing who you are, you start engaging with others on a certain equal footing, that is very, very difficult to do even with the smartest of devices today. And that's a touch and feel thing. That's a sitting around, arguing, discussing, comparing things in a setting. So settings are important. I'm a great believer that a sense of space is so critical. And I'm sure everybody on this talk will recall that when they were in school and college, there were places and spaces which had a profound impact on their learning. So the design of the place where people learn has been a subject of research for a very long time. And so, socialization cannot be done. If you have to look at the whole issue of throwing ideas at each other, the idea of a powerful debate, where everybody in the audience is engaged, as well. So there is that the psychological effect of being in a real space is very crucial. Then there are many things, of course, there are, while we are simulating many laboratories, there are certain things you cannot quite do. I mean, even putting together a good play, we're trying to do this these days through various methods, one person in one room, one in another. The interplay of emotions and character, the arguments between people, the roles and conflicts which emerge in group dynamics, which is so visible in theater, for example. very difficult to simulate. And as I said, this particularly during the college phase, the undergrad phase, it's about formation of a personality, formation of a person, formation of, and the importance of identity. So, and or you take subjects like philosophy. Okay. I can understand that if you're doing math, a lot of it can be taught virtually. You can make diagrams and sketches and do formulas and arrows. But if it's philosophy, for example, where would you start? Because it's an engagement of ideas and building on ideas and challenging ideas and reflecting on ideas. So there are many things which part of growing, which, so for example, it's not uncommon for every student quite often in a year to be in a despondent situation where only a good mentor or teacher gets you into a better mood. And that doesn't happen by appointment. We all of us remember those teachers who could make out in the class that something is bothering this young man or young lady and take them aside and walk with them in the garden or whatever and talk. So there are many aspects of personal development which cannot be done online, and we should not be attempting to do those online. But there are many we can, and we have to find the right blend. So while we have this artificial situation of COVID, it will go away. And while many people are pushing the idea that this is the only way we will learn, we shouldn't be foolish to take that comment. We will go back not to what we did before. We will go back to a situation where the comfort of every teacher, every school principal, every university professor, and every student and every parent to deal with technology and make it a slightly bigger part of the learning process or a bigger part will be there. And therefore, there are many things we'll be able to do only in physical settings. And there are many things we'll be able to do, many more things we'll be able to do online. And to me, therefore, the seamlessness means I can go from one to the other without having a break is important. And the blended means which combination of how much is what actually those who've been at it for 10 or 20 or 30 years are being able to configure that. And that is why I talked about my Scindia school, where just yesterday the team presented their works now because they started online classes just last week. And I had challenged them with the same question a few months ago on board students and they said rejuvenated teachers, because I'm just seeing how much the teachers have changed. Because they were doing that work, but they were relapsing to the easy way of teaching, and now they've had this hard time. But since they were trained and educated and prepared, they could rise. And the students also, in the case of a school like Scindia School, everybody was used to computer, they had a device, they had it in the home, they had good connectivity, so they were also experienced. And for them to therefore get engaged with each other, with other people, with unlimited content outside the school, with very good content in the school, with a whole lot of session with their housemasters and housemistresses in the case of a boarding school, or in the case of a residential university, there are many other dimensions which come into play. And so I think when we come out of this, we will get the right harmonization. But till then, some will have to struggle much harder, but some who have learned before and have put those things into place, they will be probably giving their students a much, much better experience.
Sir, I'm touching on this subject because we're talking of an offline campus and how the campus works, the dynamics of a campus, the social, the interaction, the engagement, the teamwork that normally builds up in campuses. At NIT University, I've seen, sir, and I'm sorry I'm touching this topic in the middle. I've seen this, on the hills, you created these beautiful places where students can sit together and discuss projects and all. And I do think that is very, very important in terms of building teamwork, having people engage, interact, discuss, debate, and come up with some kind of a solution on projects and all. Can you explain as a side of what made you think through that kind of a setup at the university that you created, where you created the small places on the mountains where students can just go there, sit there and discuss things?
Under the trees as well. So anyway, exactly, first of all, from the viewpoint of technology, I did mention that we set up the NIT NetVarsity in 1996.
That's right.
And then at the turn of the century, we created an entity called NIT Online Learning Limited, NOLL, which was also trying to use the blended model, but we struggled because the ability to get infrastructure which would give high quality learning was troubling, but many experiments. So you have to remember that we had been at it for 30 years before the university was created at NIT Limited, which continues as a company and works globally. And by the way, we talk of a number 36 to remember the NIT 40-year operation, which is about 36 countries that we operated in, more than 36 years now, close to 40, and about 36 million learners who benefited from short and long-term program. So the cumulative experience of that was available when we were conceptualizing the university. And we wanted it to be residential. We have 100 acres. And at peak, and it started, it's a young university, just 10 years old, and we had no big rush to shout from the tops of the screen because we're trying many, many new things. So we are inspired, for example, by how did Indians learn in Nalanda centuries ago? How did people learn in Rabindranath Tagore's institution? So there are many inspiring models, and so we had the big advantage of doing that. And all of us as learners have learned that more happens outside the classroom than inside. But we also realize that we have to put everything to use. So learners, it's a very powerful Wi-Fi campus. So you could be sitting anywhere. You could be in a group of five sitting under a tree and having an online conversation. And other people are sitting somewhere else. So we had to make sure the understructure of technology is strong. But the question is, earlier this could be done only inside a classroom. That was the constraint of the past. Now we don't have that constraint. And we are all believers that we shouldn't do either or. We should do and. We should do both. So we said, why not sit under a tree like the good old days with Wi-Fi connection and have a great conversation? So when we invite speakers from outside, we get them to, we've had some book inaugurations, big book launches of people like Arun Mahira, his book on listening.
Yeah.
He did that under the tree, which we call the listening tree, because listening is such an important skill. So, and therefore, there are many things like that in the campus, but I give an example. The admission process. 10 years ago, we decided we will not only take one dimension of testing, which is the entrance exam. Because I'm sure every student is sitting here know that that's not a fair way to be selected. It's probably appropriate way to be rejected for 99% of the people. It's not a fair way to be selected for many, many qualities that we look for in leaders of the future are not, it's not possible to test. How do you test sensitivity? How do you test creativity? How do you test social skills? How do you test how driven a person is? So from day one, we said we're going to give weightage to a personal, interpersonal interaction. So we have an interaction process and we give a lot of weightage, about a third of the weightage goes to that, and there's a panel. So it started off in the first two batches physically. Then we took it online, and that has also been through many, many, many dimensions. But this year, every admission we've done was done from the home of the prospective students, and it is mandatory for the parents also to have a session. Because we believe that they need to know as much as the student knows and to be able to guide them, because we know that this is a combined discussion at home. So this year, every one of the admissions was done from the home of the students. They would have to give other results and marks and so on, but the essential part is selection. We are selecting students and we want them to select us. So it's a mutual discovery process. So starting from admission, as an example, that's online and has been online. And I also want to say at the end of it, when you're finishing your final year, a full 6 months from year one meaning first batch onwards, full 6 months, last six semester is done in a place of your choosing, which is in an industry or a research laboratory, depending on what your future pursuits are. And that industry practice, as we call it, is not just a random process of students going and finding places on their own. These are companies where we discussed and worked out and found a problem a supervisor has, assigned a student goes and works there for 6 months, and there are two faculty members who are supervising, one from the campus in Neemrana and one in the bigger cities, so that the student has recourse to three mentors. Now, this has been going on for years, and because there was a faculty in Neemrana also involved, this was happening online. In COVID, a very interesting thing happened. Many of these companies put their employees to work from home. Our students doing industry practice went to their homes and were working from home. And it was seamless because the faculty were as they were before. The student is now working with the supervisor on the method of the company. So this from right from the beginning to the end and everything in between, there are pieces which take a lot of effort to do. And so those are things which need to be done to do a good online experience. And so I do feel that it is students need to be looking at these dimensions, because the next many months are at least very challenging. And we want every student to make the best of this time while they go through a difficulty. And we're trying our best to make sure we're sharing whatever we can with the rest of the system as well, because this is everybody's problem.
So there are a lot of questions coming in. So I'd request you to be very brief on the student questions, because I want to take as many questions as possible, sir.
All right. Understand that. Okay.
The question, this is a question from Rajesh. His question is, what factor should one look for while joining an online degree or course? So he's now talking specifically of online degree or course.
Well, I would say that if you're looking for philosophy or abstract subjects like that, it's going to be a tough call. It will be a tough call. But if you're looking for many other subjects where the faculty have codified a lot of the knowledge and can then actually build cases, very many methods to do things, particularly problem-based learning, for example. So depending on your subject, you have to look for those institutions and see what methods are they planning to implement when they talk of online learning. So if all that they're talking of is a Zoom and a Google and all of these things, it tells you the minimum is there, but then you will have to be highly disciplined. You'll have to do a lot of work on your own, because learning curves are there on both sides. So you would dabble a little, you would ask many questions of how do many things happen? How does placement happen in this difficult time, for example? How do I do industry practice? What will be the format in which I will be taught? So hopefully, as this conversation is going and as we've done it, many people are getting an idea of what they need to do. So you'll have to look at what is the method that the institution is following. And those questions should be asked. And we are encouraging our students in the admission interaction process, which is a kind of a counseling process. But it's very important for both sides to figure out to ask all these questions. And I'm sure our people are answering them, and everybody should answer what they have as a capability.
So this is a question from Bindu. Her question is, what is advisable? Should I join a college and study online, or I should drop this year because it's COVID times and start my first year with offline studies from next year?
Okay, so Bindu, if let me just say this, that we have seen that in some countries and some regions of the world, there is an encouragement for children to take a break after school and take what they call a gap year and figure out many things by doing all kind of stuff and then join college. But that is not a privilege that many can afford. Unfortunately, even if you have the privilege, this is not the time in COVID to do that, unfortunately. I wish it was possible, because it would have been a very good time for people to go out there and learn stuff, but you're going to be bound to your home. So it seems to me that it's a tough choice. And since we don't know when things will open, from our university side, I do know that we were the first to close because we recognize the problem. But we don't want to be the last to open. So the moment the laws permit us, we are fully ready even today. Full precautions taken and fully ready. But when the laws permit us, we want to start, because we recognize that in spite of everything that institutions are prepared that they do, the full experience is somewhat limited. So you would work hard at looking out for your subject on what the university options are. And if you are a very disciplined, very very independent learner, solid learner who can organize your time, then it doesn't matter, or it matters how well the institution that you're going to choose is prepared. But otherwise, you would look for the capability and the readiness of the institution at this time to take you through the difficult time and bring you out into the physical situation early. And I do feel, in fact, one more thing I feel is that I think residential campuses will have one advantage even when we open, because when you open, you can be inside a closed community. Whereas if you're commuting and going to a school or a university which is in the city where all workers are coming and going out, there'll have to be more precautions. So I presume that closed campuses will have the benefit of opening early and therefore have lesser time. But that's a choice that you have to make depending on the subjects that you're taking. But unfortunately, COVID is denying us one good option for many children, which is to have taken a gap year, which is a good idea for many people to consider under normal circumstances.
Okay. This student, sir, this is another question from a student. He's actually a science student, and his question is, if I join an online degree course, how will practicals be conducted?
So, depending on the subject, there are the possibility of virtual labs. So, virtual labs is again not something you can buy and install. It's evolved and developed by the faculty members because faculty do it as part of the course. So, when you are looking at the universities you're talking to, be very pointed about asking them in which subjects are the labs ready. Because if some subject the labs cannot, the wet lab, for example, you can see the simulation. So, perhaps you can see someone doing it, you may not do it yourself. But it will be important for the institution to make sure that when you come back onto a campus, so they'll have to juggle with the sequencing a little bit to make sure that before you finish your term, that you get that experience. Because it is possible for institutions which are creative and flexible to juggle the sequence of labs and so on to make sure that you don't miss the experience. But in many subjects, virtual labs and digital labs exist. Either you do the experiment directly yourself through simulators, or you see a very good demonstration of things done by others so you can draw lessons, and points you to many other things to see in content which is available everywhere. So it is indeed getting more and more possible to deal with the practical things and laboratory issues to an increasing extent, and some institutions obviously are better equipped and better prepared to do it.
Sir, this is about placements, and I'm rephrasing the question that's come to me. How do you see the placement scenario moving forward? That's the first part. And would a student who has gone through an online education over the initial period have any disadvantage when it comes to the placement at some point in time?
So, I guess we all know that employers do look for how much you have learned. And I'm quite certain that in this year and the next year, people who are graduating, their employers are going to test very hard to see where people came, what do they do, how much they have learned. So I'm going to tell all the students who are online today that they shouldn't bother about it, because by the time they are on campus and placement happens, they will not be saying that I did my first semester online. So you don't need to worry about the problem. But having said that, students who are passing out this year and those who will pass out next year, I think there we have to see the method in which institutions offer this facility to learners. Now, in very large institutions, obviously, a child gets lost, so being learner-centered, student-centered becomes difficult. But in very good institutions, the institution is very highly focused on each child, each student, and they try and do a matching process. And those institutions, and unfortunately not too many, who make these arrangements for internships, make it possible for the student and the employer to see themselves, see each other for a while before the placement happens. And so for example, in our 9 years so far, it's been 100% placement simply because the structure exists. So it is true that we don't know number of jobs which will be there in the country, will they shrink or not shrink? But that's a macro problem. We are concerned about micro, one learner at a time, one student at a time. And so how many options can we create in front of each learner to be interviewed? How many options can we create in front of each learner for industry practice? So our industry is coming in the seventh semester to look at students to whom they want to offer internship to me. That's the placement. Fortunately for this year, that placement happened for us last year. Students are already there. And those who are in the seventh semester, we now are actually getting quite busy to see how will we engage them with the same 400 or 500 companies who are partners for us. We have a much smaller number of students who go out every year. So these structural methods actually are a bigger determinant of placement. Like, for example, some of the older institutions have built mechanisms to work with industry. So those mechanisms are very important. So those are like the bridges for placement. But I would say once again that anybody who's on this call, don't worry about this problem, because by the time you come to final year, people would have forgotten.
I think 4 years is my advice to students also would be 4 years is a long time. The worry is for the students who just passed out or about to pass out. That's a bigger worry for them. But you are in a safe zone at this point in time, because the world has conquered every problem, and 4 years is too long a time for us not to conquer a problem.
My own view is that these students who are coming in now will be exercising themselves to build a skill which will be very handy for them even in the second, third and fourth year.
Exactly.
If the institutions have the capability, and they'll be far better equipped. They'll be far more independent learners. Yeah. They'll be more disciplined learners, and they'll be technology savvy learners.
In fact, the next question is something related to the skill that you're talking of, sir. This question is, do I do an online degree or go for online certification program that allows me the freedom to choose my curriculum? And the student wants to be in computer sciences. So he's now choosing between a skill and a formal education. What is your take on that, sir?
Well, see, this problem is difficult because most employers still worry about where you came from, what degree you have. We all know that even in society, your standing to a large extent, unfortunate as it may be, is quite determined by what degree you have. But if you're pursuing a degree, which you could still be doing a lot of certificate program to enrich your capability or strengthen yourself. So I still continue to believe that a first degree is a very important thing to settle you into a social framework, because it's not only the subject you will learn. I talked a lot about socialization, forming your relationships, friends, and so on and so forth, engaging with mentors, building a cohort. So that you do through the best way through being in a program which is formal. But I do want to mention that even at our university, our students, busy as they are 24/7, many of them do additional certificate program because they're really interested in the subject. They want to go deeper into this.
Yeah, yeah.
And they know that the best course on a subject may not be available in the college. No university can claim that. So they will go and listen to one lecture or one course to the best guy on the subject that they want to listen to, even if the person is a canned lecture and you can listen to the lecture if he's not alive. But to me, I would still encourage everybody to look at the social value of a degree and not leave it at that, but then keep looking for what more we want to do. And then choose your options and electives which add on to what you're doing. And in fact, I do want to say that in our integrated MBA program, which is a 4-year program, 1/3 of the courses are chosen by students as they come into third and fourth year. It's a 4-year program. So they start making their choices. And one more thing is that, and I'm sure every student will like this, particularly when there's some controversy going on in Delhi University on what to do with electives and what to do with your social skills. We give credits for things like drama. If you're in the dramatics club, we reckon you have spent more than the number of hours doing drama in a semester than you did in a maths class. Do we value that experience? Of course we do. And therefore, we will give credit for those subjects as well. And we're trying to widen that because we recognize, as employers tell us, that what are the capabilities? They need a vast range of capabilities in the leaders of tomorrow. And so this option and freedom, if your institution where you go doesn't have it, you should still exercise it by picking up other certification programs which are available to you online. So you combine your formal certificate program, degree program, along with the options you have. And of course, you have the option in the institution where you go, where you can pick and choose, because you have only 24 hours a day. Then it makes it easier for you.
No, in fact, I'll second what Mr. Pawar said to all the students. As a counselor, I am saying this, that please don't give up your formal education, because this 4 years is not just about what you learn, but your socializing, your soft skills, everything gets improved. You know, you're working in teams, you're dealing with people. All those things are very important. Everything is a learning, not just the marks that you score. And along with that, add a skill to it. You know, it will be far, far better for you. So don't give up formal education for a certification at an undergrad level right after class 12. That might not take you far in your career path. That's my opinion about it. Yeah. Sir, a lot of students are asking this question. What is the difference between early admission and regular admission at NIT University?
Well, see, we have been seized with many, many unsolved problems in higher education. And as you saw, I talked about how we deal with the process of going from university to a job. So we build a very effective bridge through the 6 month internship so that students know where they are headed and they are secure. They don't have a madness at the end of the final year for looking for a job. But we recognize that the much more unsolved, bigger unsolved problem is admission from school into university. No student knows where they will reach. No parent knows where the child will reach. No university or college knows who's going to land up. So it's an absolutely opaque system. So we've been working very hard to see how do we build an admissions bridge? How do we reach a certain number of schools and start talking to students in class 8, for example? What are their dreams? What do they want to do in life? And do a dialogue with them and engage a faculty to do these conversations. So therefore, in your question about early admission, we figured that students in class 12 go for their, start doing board exams with the big tension of where will I get admission. It's a really, we've experienced as parents, we've experienced that. So we said, what can the university do to give an option to a child, which they may or may not be stuck with earlier? So we start our admission process even before board begins. And of course, only those students who think they can cope with both the process, and they tend to be brighter students or students with a lot of initiative, they come into the early admission process. They go through the whole process in detail. We don't have the 12th grade marks, but we have 10th, and we have our interaction process. And if we feel they're up to a certain standard and above, we offer them early admission. Now, the good thing is the students are not bound. They can opt out because this may not be them getting a better choice later. But what we found is that those who take this admission option are then relieved during the board time to give their board exams well, because that's what they're studying for, and we should not be distracting them from that. So we feel that as this gets more and more popular, more and more institutions should offer it so that students can concentrate on their board exam and do well in that exam. Because many of these competitive exams actually distract students in class 12 or even 11, some even earlier, that you're preparing for an exam or you're getting an education. So for us, the early admission process is a way to provide this option to students who are taking initiative or who are bright and they think they can do both things. And we are getting a larger and larger number of students coming in through these methods, and they tend to be very bright students. So that's an option which we have. Exercise.
This is a question from Shivam Kumar Singh, sir. His question is, what are the possible ways through which online exams can be taken by universities during the COVID time? So what are the possible ways that, because there is a lot of controversy that's happening about whether the exams must happen, not happen at a university system.
So it goes back again, Shivam, it goes back to the fact that there already are many exams which are taken online today, like an SAT or a GRE. Worldwide, which are valid. So first thing I want to say is it is possible to do many examination online remotely. And even before the university was created, NIIT Limited, the company, which trained millions of people, we were working with many people who had these platforms for proctored examination that remotely you could do it. And today there are many tools and technologies. So we, for example, are doing exams, and I'm told that this year the university has had a very successful process, and so have some other institutions. So first thing I want to say is that for many, many subjects, it's possible to do examinations online, which are reliable and which can be proctored, and you have a camera and you can see what's going on, and there's a lot of AI tools which are put in to see that your eyes are not moving left and right. There are many ways to do it. So, but then institutions should have done it. You can't suddenly buy something and say we'll do the exam tomorrow, because then you're on a learning curve. So there are methods to do it, and I think it's technically been established to be possible, but then the habit, the behaviors, the skills of the administrators, the willingness of faculty to do the homework, to do their exam online, those things matter. And more institutions are realizing they have to learn how to do it.
So this is a question from Neeta G. Patil, sir. Neeta's question is, how will emphasis be given on engagement during online semester? Will there be any group work?
Will there be any?
Group work.
Yeah, so engagement is the right word. I think you heard me also say that in Sindhya School, the principal and his team got back with a very strong presentation to me saying, Mr. Pawar, you wrote this, we want to tell you what you've done. And the word they chose was rejuvenated teachers, engaged students. That's the word they chose. So engagement basically now is a very, very rich word. So even when the teacher is talking to you on Zoom, are you engaged or not engaged? For example, right? So there is a training to be done for the parent as well, for small children, for example. They have to ensure that a few minutes before and a few minutes after or whatever, they are creating a setting. This is for young children. For adults, the problems are different. But there also you have to be prep up for it. You can't run into class like you do in a class without not thinking of what the teacher will do. So there's some prior preparation which you have to do. There may be post-Zoom sessions. So in fact, in our university and in the school, we're trying to minimize the Zoom hours, as they call them, and do engagement before and after and during. So you have your own group of friends and you are active with them all the time. Okay, you're on social media and Neeta, you are engaged with your friends on many different fora. So the institutions are trying to create these platforms, some of them have, and some are public platforms, but institutions are creating platforms where you can do even a mentored collaboration. A mentor, not only a teacher, you may have a fourth year student joining in a first year group and say, I'll mentor this group. That happens at our place, for example. So engagement is on many fronts. It's during the session, before the session, it's after the session, it's between the teacher and the student, it is between students, it's with your faculty. So for example, setting aside a certain number of hours given to each student each week, you have so much time in which you can engage with the faculty of your choice. So can you go through your one single sign-on on the screen and ask for that time and be pointed to a teacher, almost like an app, and block that time and get that time. So engagement needs that infrastructure and capability. But engagement is many dimensions, and I personally believe that all of us have got at least 2 hours extra every day because you cut out on commute time, right? And you're not tiring yourself with unproductive travel. So that is the time for engagement. And I do find that all of us, faculty included, are far more flexible in giving time because they're also doing a work from home. So you'll be surprised on how many faculty, and if you, maybe your teachers have already given you time at odd hours, as you would call it, before dinner, after dinner, to give a consultation, because time has become kind of seamless for people now. You want to work X hours, you can figure out the hours. So engagement is a set of things which have to be done through a capability, through an infrastructure, through practices, through readiness of teachers, through support of parents. So it's an involved term. It's not just get engaged, we tell a student and suddenly something happens.
So this is an interesting question that came from Gaurav, sir. Because we're talking of choosing a college, I think his question becomes very interesting. Is there any way that, I'm just rephrasing the question, sir. Is there any way that a student can understand whether the online learning is live lectures or recorded lectures or just presentations?
So I would actually encourage you, Gaurav, if you've narrowed down the universities, then be very demanding and ask them to demonstrate what they do.
Yeah.
That's the tough thing I'm putting on the table even for our university folks, but I would urge you to do that. Ask them. But to your point, a live lecture, if you are attending one, you'll know. You'll know it because you'll raise your hand, you'll ask a question, you get a reply. But there's also a value for a recorded lecture. So at least the two institutions that I'm deeply involved in, the Scindia School as well as the university, every lecture is recorded. And as a student, you can navigate that because you may just for some reason have had something else going on in collaborative terms with a bunch of students or something else, and you miss it, or you want to go back to it again. So you can go back to it again. So there's value. And I can tell you, even when you're in a physical classroom, and everybody will agree with this, we all have those few minutes in the class where our mind was somewhere else and the concept went by. Every class we have it. So with recorded lectures, you can go back and say, I understood this part, I didn't understand that part, and you can go and do that. So recorded lectures have a value. And then presentation is just one medium. Just today, like you saw the complicated circle and graph I showed you, I couldn't have explained it to you without just words. I couldn't explain it fully because I needed time. So here people have to prepare, teachers have to prepare what will they present. Because it, unlike a classroom which has a huge board and many things are stuck there, here we don't have that. So they have to redo their presentations and they have to use it carefully. They have to use videos carefully. They have to use images carefully. They have to look into your eyes carefully. And all they have to call upon a student to make a carefully. You can do many more things like that. So the functionality of these platforms is very, very rich. And it's a seamlessness, the ability of the faculty member to move from one format to another while you are in a conversation. Or if you're doing a session with a faculty member, and you say, I didn't understand that, the faculty should be able to go to that recorded session, go to the 5 minutes and say, okay, let's see it together. It is this capability which you cannot do if you start online learning yesterday. You know, that's what I was trying to make as a point. It needs that infrastructure, and many people on that journey, you have to figure that out when you're talking to people and where they are.
During this entire conversation, there is one thing that we kept coming back to, which is adaptability. What do you see is the role of a parent, a student, and a teacher in this new norm called online learning, where much of the teaching might be happening online, and the students, parents, and teachers need to adapt to that or change the way they would go about doing their work, which is not similar to what it was earlier.
So I think let me start with what I think is the more important one and the less difficult one.
Yeah.
The most important is the teacher and the most difficult is the teacher. I'll talk about that.
Yeah.
But parents. So depending on the age of the child, and the parents have a much bigger role with very young children. And I know that all these school going kids, parents have a big say in their life while they're in school. But when they come to college, they don't want parents to have anything to do. That's part of growing up. But parents have to recognize their role. And simple things like setting up a place which has no disturbance. Not very easy for every parent, but parents have to. And parents are doing wonderful things. We hear stories about how much parents are doing. I'm sure you read the piece yesterday about a person who wanted to buy a computer, sold his cow for the child. I mean, parents will do many things for children. So setting up the space and the infrastructure, then understanding the timetable, they have to know exactly what the timetable is and what are the facilities available to the student for checking doubts and so on, and keeping an eye on whether the child is using all those capabilities and is supported. So for example, I definitely don't want a parent to come into the screen and start yelling at the teacher, which has happened in the schools, and teachers get harassed for that reason. But being mindful that there's a process going on, being mindful that students need the support. And in many places, it's sensible to put a gap between two sessions and for the parent to recognize that that's a time when the child needs to be interacted with if the parent happens to be at home. And then engaging with the school. So the parent-teacher meeting used to be the only thing in universities. We don't have that. But good institutions should be opening channels for parents who are dealing now with their children, and the children are showing up all the stress. So there are many things that parents need to do to take care, and they all are committed. I don't have a question, just that we have to give them a bare minimum exposure, and that has been happening in good institutions, that the principals are aware that they have to teach the parents on what to do to help the child. And the children and parents are rising to that occasion, because they just have to be mindful and conscious, and then they are being able to do it. The real challenge is with teachers who've studied as students in a certain way, studied education in a certain way, and have been doing education in a certain way, and have fully prepared their methods and examples over decades sometimes, and have the course material. And to change from that is not easy. And that's why I said that is not something you can do in a week or a month or a year. I am convinced about that. It takes much, much longer. But clearly, I think I find that now, given this difficult situation, in talking to many heads of institutions, they're also saying that I had bright teachers and not so bright teachers, and now I'm dividing them differently. I'm seeing active learners and not so active learners among teachers. So who are the ones who are working hard to adapt to the new situation? So teachers have to know there is no option but to be a learner in kindergarten on online learning. And that's why I brutally said exhausted teachers board, because I think we're catching people's attention. That, is it really a problem, or am I the only one? You're not the only one. And if you're a teacher, your institution has to invest in time and effort, as many institutions are doing. So the biggest challenge actually is for the teacher, because how they do the teaching learning process, how they do learner-centered outcome-based learning is a whole new problem. And how they involve other students, and how they involve, let's say if I'm a good teacher, I have a fourth year student in college and I have five first year students who have a problem. Can I get that fourth year student to look after this 5 years for one or two sessions? These are not tools they have been exposed to. They've done it physically, but what are the digital equivalents of physical tools is a big journey for teachers. Big journey. So they have to learn. I asked the school principal in my school, I said, you walk down the corridor of the classroom and without peeping in, you pretty much know what's going on. I said, what's your digital equivalent of that? Do you know? He said, I have no clue. I said, learn that in the next 1 week. And things like that. So for teachers and stuff, for students, as I said, you have to obviously look for a place which is, first of all, student-centric, because they'll be worrying about these things. But more than that, where they have this kind of readiness. But whatever level of readiness you have, depending on the institution you choose and you get and the subject you have to remember that for this next few months, you'll have to be very disciplined. I'm sorry to say that, but if you don't take this seriously, you'll be a very big loser. So what does discipline mean? You'll get a timetable. You'll get recommendations of what pre-work to do. You'll get a recommendation to do post-class teamwork or review. This simple aspect of discipline should be an absolute must, because in school, mom looked at it at home and the teacher looked at it in school. Here, no one's watching. So, in fact, in our induction program at the university, one very famous school principal, many of you may have heard of him, Arun Kapoor.
Yeah.
He used to do a session called Unlearning 101. He says, what do you have to unlearn and leave behind in school when you come into a university where we are giving you independence? And do you recognize that you have independence? And are you responsible? So I would say that this COVID has forced you to deal with that freedom and independence now. So discipline is the most difficult thing to do, but the most important thing to do. And if you start with simple things like that, the other things will fall into place. So you will be given guidelines to follow. And I would really, really seriously urge you that this time around, don't miss on that. Take that as seriously as you can. And my saying may or may not help, but I hope it does. I truly wish that you take this seriously and be disciplined on how you have to do this, because this is going to be very different. And it's very different, as you may have seen the last few weeks and months before. So becoming responsible, becoming disciplined, becoming independent for a few months before you get back to school and get back to your habits is really what I would urge you to do. And I wish and hope that you can do this one thing well, because it make a big difference. If your foundations in the early part of the semester and the year are not good, you'll struggle. So don't let that happen. And work seriously on that.
The last question, sir, rather not a question, but if you can actually summarize for all the listeners out here in terms of, because you talked of creating good content, which is online learning content, you talked of engagement, you talked of adaptability, you talked of learner-centered, and you also talked of outcome-based. Is there a summary of thoughts that you have, because you've been through it for 40 years, have thought through it, executed some, you know, worked on some, and you know, created a university also based on that. What is your thought process into this entire online learning and how we should move ahead as a country?
That's a tall order to do it in a few minutes, but let me put myself in the shoes of a 12th class student.
Yes, sir.
Let me imagine I'm a 12th class student. So, I have my grades now, I have my marks. So my conventional method of saying with these marks I'll get this institution, drop that. It may not be valid this year because the whole system is collapsed and broken. So I would say, ask yourself a couple of questions. What do you really want to do? Remember, you have more freedom this year because everybody's confused. Okay, no one's going to tell you do this, do that, because everybody's confused. So first, spend a lot of time on saying, what do you really want to study? What do you really want to do? And then narrowing down your institution, not on the criteria which you have been groomed to do for last 3 or 4 years, but you really want to do now. And make a shortlist. And in those areas and institutions, as I said, do a little more search. Be demanding. Ask them for conversations. Put questions there. Wait for answers and do it directly. Because the world is confused, I think the social dialogue on these issues may not be very dependable, much like news these days, it's not dependable because everybody's all over the place. So it's a personal agenda. So for those handful of places you're choosing, be direct with them. Now you may have to change that list with time, but be direct with them. That's the second. And in that conversation, try and understand this whole question that we've been talking about around your subject, around how the institution is coping with this. I think that's, to me, a very big criteria this year, because the first many months and the foundation will be based on that. And we've talked of a number of issues today. They should help you to make a list of what you want to probe, what you want to study. I do know that many of you have visited the websites, many institutions, but you may have done it superficially because you didn't know what your marks will be. You don't know what. Now you'll be a demanding student. And be confident at this time that you may get better options than you imagine if you think it through well. And then as you become demanding and start putting your questions down, organize yourself, think it through, and then first, do as much as you can on those 5 or 6 institutions' website. Then put questions, and if there are numbers available, or it depends, see the responsiveness of that place as well, and test out what you can see, and form a personal opinion by direct contact, rather than taking. Because normally in the social media world, we look for number of likes and who says what. These times are very confused. Be direct. You can be direct. Be direct is one of my advice. And the various questions that many young people have asked, very relevant questions, you've heard them. You've heard our comments. Mahesh has asked a number of pointed questions which we tried to comment. And after this again, you can send many more questions to Mahesh, and I'll be happy to have me or my colleagues answer as many of them as possible.
And one last question, sir. You know, because of your journey of 40 years, are there any pitfalls that you would want either the students or the regulators or the government to be wary of, because you attempted a lot, succeeded on a few, and also, as you said earlier, online learning, you could not because it was slightly ahead of time. So is there anything that you would want to advise the people listening out there, which we can think through?
See, most of them, I presume, are students, because regulator, the conversation has to be very different. Yeah. But for regulators, there's one line that you have to reform. You have to liberalize. You have to let a faculty member decide what they want to teach, leave alone a department, leave alone an institution, leave alone a board. Give much more academic freedom. Right now, UGC is saying 40% online, right? So this is a game with very few rules. I'd say regulators just free up and let institutions prove themselves. For students, I think I have made some comments. For teachers, perhaps, is the biggest, most difficult task. That how do you educate yourself at full speed on the many things, unless, of course, you've been involved and your institution has been involved to force you to do many things you didn't like earlier, but suddenly you find that you can now you become a fish who can swim while others are not being able to swim. And you can put those even limited skills that you can quickly rise up and learn fast. So invest time for teachers. And for students, I'm telling you, it's a great time. You have many choices. And the old formulae of what determines what is all collapsed. You can get admissions even before the end of the year, which many people will have to wait for. And you can, if someone gives you a choice to change later, exercise those choices. Be a little more, should we say, self-centered, because institutions are wanting to be you-centered. So it'll align itself.
I think, thank you so much for talking to us, sir. I'll just add to what Mr. Pawar said. This 1 year is actually a free ticket for all of you. This pandemic is not because of you. You are not the only one carrying the burden on your shoulders. It's important for you to understand that whatever happens in this 1 year, not many questions will come towards you because it's being faced by everyone. So use this 1 year very productively. Don't stay idle. Don't wait for things to happen to you. Can start moving in terms of adding skill sets and so on and so forth while you wait for your formal education, formal degree courses to start. Just ensure that there is no gap in terms of not doing anything, waiting for something to happen. But it's a free ticket for you. And this time, none of us as students have ever got, mind you. So you are, in a certain sense, at an advantage, or rather, as the Prime Minister himself said, that, you know, it's an opportunity that you must look at, and this is an opportunity for you. Thank you, Mr. Pawar, for joining us today. And the way we've had this conversation, I'll come back to you maybe in the next couple of months with one more conversation like this, sir, because quite a few questions I would not take because of paucity of time, and I will come back to you on this.
You can send them to me and I'll try and answer them directly from where they came from.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thanks so much. I enjoyed the discussion, Mahesh. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much, sir.